Hey to everyone out there watching online. We are so glad that you're here worshiping with us today. My name is Trevor, and I'm one of the pastors here at Mulberry Street UMC. We would like to just welcome you to worshiping with us for our new room worship service. As you can see here in the sanctuary, we're going to have some great worship for y'all later with Blane, myself. Sarah's going to be sharing a call to worship, and you're going to be hearing from our pastor, Jeff Cook. So we've got a lot of really, really special things in store for this worship service planned for you guys. Just a couple of things we want to let y'all know and make y'all aware of is that you can worship with us on Facebook. You can like us on Facebook and online. If you are a family who would like to get more connected, whether you have children or youth, there are ways for you to get more connected online via our Facebook groups, Mulberry Street UMC Families, and we would love to connect with you all in that way. There are also ways for you to give online. We encourage you to go to our website, mulberrymethodist.org, or our Facebook page to find us and find out those ways to give and to stay connected. We're so just excited to be able to stay connected with our Mulberry Street family, whether you have been worshiping with us for years or this is the first time you're tuning in. We're just really, really thankful that we get to worship with you and to share this experience with you in your homes or wherever you are. So as we begin this time of worship, I'd like to turn things over to Sarah this morning.
Thank you, Trevor. Hey, y'all. I'm Sarah, and this morning we're going through Matthew chapter 12 in Jeff's sermon. And I was reading over it, and it just made me so happy because I don't know if you have like little kid memories of church, but Palm Sunday used to always be a big one for me. And I remember I had this teacher in fifth grade, a Sunday school teacher named Miss Nancy, who loved the Old Testament, loved scripture, and loved teaching us Hebrew names as a part of her teaching. And so she taught us one of the phrases that we read today in Matthew 12. And it says, whenever they are welcoming Jesus into the city, they said, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord," as a greeting for him coming into the city walls. And she taught us how to say that. She taught us so many things, and this is one of the few that has actually stuck for years and years. But she taught us how to say, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord" in Hebrew. And it is Baruch haba Baruch Hashem Adonai, which I probably just butchered. But I can't read those words now without thinking that phrase. And it's just resonating with me, this idea of how do we welcome Jesus into this space? How do we welcome Christ into our cities and our neighborhoods and our own homes and our own lives? And so I pray that as we enter into this time of worship today, that you would just welcome Jesus as King wherever you are, that you would just prepare your spirit to just experience him and welcome him, because he is King, he rules all, and with his rule comes peace and joy. And we all want a little bit of that right now. Would you pray with me as we go into worship? Lord, we thank you so much for who you are, for coming as a human being to come and live life with us, for giving us a chance in person to welcome you. But Lord, we welcome your spirit into this place today. We welcome you into our homes and into our hearts and into our lives, and just ask that you would have your way here. Blessed are you, O Lord. Help us to worship you today, in spirit and in truth. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
King of glory, coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes, yeah. I see His love and mercy washing over all our sin. People sing, Hosanna, Hosanna. Take their place with selfless faith, with selfless faith. I see a near revival stirring as we pray and seek. We're on our knees, we're on our knees.
Let us pray. Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing and acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. May you, in this moment, enter into our hearts and lives just as you entered into the hearts and lives of those people on that first Palm Sunday as Jesus resolutely set his face to the cross. And Lord, may our hearts be open to the coming of the Savior to do the salvific work in our lives that you desire to do. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So this morning, we are reading from the Gospel of Matthew, and we're reading from the 21st chapter, verses 1 through 11. I invite you to hear the word of the Lord. When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, 'Look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey.'" The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, saying, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." We thank God for the reading of this, his holy word. Did you hear the question that was asked of us at the end of today's text? Who is this? This was the question asked by Jerusalem as a relatively obscure man. Jesus rode into town along with a great crowd. Grand parades are usually reserved for stars, heroes, and dignitaries. Charles Lindbergh was given a ticker tape parade in New York City in honor of his solo flight across the Atlantic. Nearly 750,000 pounds of ticker tape poured into the streets to commemorate this incredible achievement. A bigger ticker tape parade was held for astronaut John Glenn after he became the first American to orbit the Earth in a spacecraft. The sanitation department cleaned up 3,474 tons of ticker tape, confetti, and other debris along a 7-mile stretch as the people celebrated in jubilation for this incredible achievement. When Jesus came into town, the people of Jerusalem, they had no idea really what to expect. What to make of this multitude of people who were accompanying him from the countryside. Josephus, who was a Jewish historian, estimated the crowd to be in the 3 million range. No wonder the gospel writer Matthew describes Jerusalem as a city in turmoil as Jesus arrived. Can you imagine 3 million people suddenly and unexpectedly descending upon our city? Can you imagine being less than prepared for that moment? I wonder how many tons of cloaks and palm branches were cleaned up by the sanitation department of Jerusalem. Imagine if Jesus had been the Messiah that all the Jerusalem people had been looking for. In fact, he was, but they just didn't know it. They instead were looking for a powerful king of military and political might, ready to restore Israel's power and clout. But they weren't looking for this Jesus, this humble one. I imagine no one in the city would have grumbled or complained about cleaning up cloaks, palm branches, or the like that comes with a crowd of 3 million if it had been the person they were expecting. If it had been this great military ruler, this great political ruler, But instead, the politicians of the day, the religious leaders of the day, they were left scratching their heads at the most improbable of parades. Their bewilderment soon turned to anger as they faced a massive cleanup effort, all because a nobody in their eyes had stirred up the masses. The authorities must have exclaimed, "A riot! This Jesus must be stopped. An end must be put to this turmoil. Who is this?" If only the city had understood the significance of that question. The great irony of this question is that Jerusalem was considered to be the political and religious and cultural center of the world at that time. If anyone should have grasped the significance of this moment, the significance of what was happening, it should have been the people of the city. But perhaps it is fitting that the most unlikely cast of characters were the ones who grasped the significance of this moment. It was the cast of characters, many who had followed Jesus on this route from Galilee, who understood who Jesus was. So as the people from the city, as they saw this ruckus taking place, they had to be blown away to find that the cause was not a great king, but rather a nondescript man riding on the back of not one, but two donkeys. It had to be almost comical to witness if you didn't grasp the significance of this moment. With cries of derision, can you hear those cries? The people of the city exclaim, "Who is this? Is this man the reason our city is being turned upside down?" In answer to this question, the crowd, surely filled with many disciples touched by the life and ministry of Jesus, they exclaimed, "This is the prophet Jesus from Galilee, from Nazareth in Galilee." You can almost, in response to those followers in the crowd, hear the naysayers. You can almost hear their groans. You can almost see their eyes rolling in derision. How could anyone view this man as a prophet? This only served to further incite the anger of the religious leaders who thought that Jesus was making a mockery of their religious establishment. But on top of the people's claim that Jesus was a prophet was their loud cries of Hosanna. You know, the word Hosanna literally means save. Save! The crowd shouted. Save! Rang out those words from the hearts of the people who knew what Jesus was bringing to the table. It's quite likely that even those in the crowd that followed Jesus closely really did not have a clear understanding of that word Hosanna that they were crying out today. They didn't have a clear understanding of what Jesus was really trying to accomplish in this moment, of the depth of the saving work that was yet to come. Can you imagine if they had known in that moment that at the end of this week that Jesus would be going to a cross to save the world? Can you imagine if the people in the crowd at the end of this week would have known that as Jesus hung on the cross 3 days later, that there would be an empty tomb? I wonder if Jesus thought as he heard these words, "Hosanna," cried out, I wonder if he thought, "That's exactly what I'm here to do. How right you are, but how little you really understand." Even without a full understanding, the crowd was clearly articulating what Jesus came to do. This crowd, largely comprised of people from Jesus' home region of Galilee, demonstrated at least some grasp of what Jesus came to do. But ironically, the religious and political leaders did not grasp what those less versed in religion and politics already understood well. They understood that Jesus had come to offer them something incredible and amazing. And the reason they knew this is because they had developed a relationship with Jesus. And those are words for us to grasp and hold on to, a relationship. Do we have the kind of relationship with Jesus that would allow us to stand in a crowd and cry out, "Save, Hosanna," and understand that there's a greater depth to those words than we can begin to imagine? Through this relationship, those in the crowd, those followers of Jesus, understood enough to know that Jesus had changed their lives forever. The sick had been healed. Sinners had experienced forgiveness, and the weight of guilt had somehow left them. The poor felt like someone finally cared. The widow and the orphan, they no longer felt alone. This is why the crowds gathered. This is why, as Jesus rode into town, the people let loose with joyous, uninhibited praise, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." They had been saved from that which had taken their life and had been given new life in return. Today, we too are confronted with this question: who is this? We have the choice of responding like the crowds accompanying Jesus, those voices that rang out Hosanna, full of praise for the saving work of Jesus in our lives. But the other option is to respond like the people of the city, oblivious to the presence of the Messiah, even though he is right in front of us. Yes, Jesus, this unassuming man from Nazareth of Galilee that entered the world in a manger and made this triumphal entry into Jerusalem, somewhat awkwardly, on the back of two donkeys, he is the one who alone can offer us God's saving grace. There was a woman who was driving home one night, and the weather was really nasty. Rain was coming down in buckets, and visibility was very poor. Seeing taillights ahead of her, she locked into these taillights, and she followed that car in front of her to make sure she stayed between the lines. Wherever that car went, she followed closely. If it turned right, she went right. If it turned left, she went left. And all of a sudden, the car in front of her came to a sudden stop. She began to wonder what happened. Perhaps the car in front of her had hit a deer. Maybe it had broken down. She began to feel uncomfortable, fearing that this car that had stopped in the middle of the road might put her in danger, might lead to an accident if other cars followed too closely. Much to her alarm, the car in front of her turned off her lights, and then there was a knock on her window, and she was afraid. As she looked up and as she rolled down her car window, she asked the man, "Do you have a problem?" The man replied by stating, "Well, that's the question I intended to ask you." She responded that, "I'm not the one who stopped in the middle of the road and turned off my car lights." The man replied that, "We're not in the middle of the road. We're stopped in my driveway." The woman had chosen the wrong car to follow. She had gone down the wrong path. She did not arrive at her intended destination. Similarly, in life, we can follow the wrong leader who can lead us down the wrong path and who can take us to the wrong destination. For many people in Jerusalem on that first Palm Sunday, Jesus was a nobody, clumsily riding into town on the back of two donkeys, stirring up the masses and destroying their city. They preferred a leader who looked the part, riding in on this great horse, proclaiming political and military victory. But it was their stubborn adherence adherence to the preferences, to their preferences they had held tight to and held so dear for so long, that caused them to look for a different leader and a different road. God was not supposed to be humble. God was not supposed to turn the other cheek. God was not supposed to associate with people like tax collectors and prostitutes. In other words, in their eyes, God was not supposed to act like Jesus. Who is this? Jesus may not always enter into our lives in the way that we prefer or even in the way that we think he should. Sometimes Jesus will show up in the most unexpected ways and in the most unexpected places. And he does so in order to come and to shape and mold our lives in ways that perhaps we're not even aware they need to be shaped and molded. The question for us is, are we ready to receive this Jesus? Even when he comes in ways that challenge us, the ways that we're not ready for, ways that we don't prefer, but ways that are best for us and can lead us down the path of salvation. When Jesus shows up in the form of a stranger, the poor, or the destitute, will we allow him into our lives just like so many waving their palm branches on that first Sunday? Or will we reject him, like so many rejected him that Palm Sunday, deriding him as an illegitimate king because he did not merit their idea of a Messiah? Who is this? The answer to this question determines whether we follow Jesus or whether we look down another road for their answers that we seek today. We live in a time in which we need hope. We've already been given a path, and the path we follow is the path that Jesus desires to lead us down. The question is, will we walk down that path, or will we lock in on another set of taillights, hoping to find what we're looking for, but never quite getting there? It's my prayer that we choose the path we follow wisely, that we'll lock in on Jesus and never turn back. It's in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit that I pray this prayer for all of us, that we will answer, "Who is this?" by shouting the name of Jesus and the words Hosanna from the bottom of our hearts and from the depth of our soul. Amen.
Touching every heart, I worship you, worship you. You are here, you're healing every heart, I worship you. worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you. I worship you. 'Cause you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness.
You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working.
Light in the darkness, my God, that is.